In today's khutbah, I would like to talk about water. And you might think, what am I talking about? Water is considered to be the most essential need of a human being. It is the source of our life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Anbiya, ayat number 30 says, جَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ, that we have made everything alive or living from water. So life and water are connected to one another. And not only that, it is also considered in Quran to be one of the symbol of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Means even if you look at the clouds, and even in before that, the winds which pushes the clouds from the sea to the inland, that the winds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is rahmah. Whereas it's just a preliminary situation of pushing the clouds inwards so that the water can go down on the earth. It is also for us, in our Sharia, it is a source of taharat for us. As in the month of Ramadan, we talked about two sources of purification. Physical, source of purification is water, and the spiritual source of purification is tawbah. And of course, you know, we also have emphasis in the Sharia about not wasting it. So this issue of access to clean water is in a way a basic human right. And very few Canadians would even think twice about it. Whenever we want water, you just, you know, turn the tap on and drink it or use it. Nobody worries about it because we expect the government to monitor the source of water and, you know, the purification process and how the water reaches to our homes. So this expectation that we have with the government here is valid and reasonable because we live in a country which is known for, you know, being a rich country, not only resource-wise, even from water perspective. We are surrounded by water from three sides. Yet we sometimes do not realize that for generations, you know, Canada has not been able to provide access to clean water for the indigenous people. You know, sometimes we take things for granted, and we praise this country, and it's valid. I'm not saying that it's the wrong thing. But do not forget that there are people around who have been in this land before us who are still suffering for decades because, you know, if you look at the pledge made by Trudeau when he was standing first time in the elections, 2015, he promised to end the scourge of unsafe water for more than 100 First Nation communities across Canada. The government had a 5-year plan, however, they missed that, which ended last year. But the good thing is at least the government acknowledged that they have not been able to fulfill the promise made by the Prime Minister, and the Indigenous Service Minister, Mark Miller, last year acknowledged that it's unacceptable in a country that is financially one of the most wealthy in this world and water rich, and the reality is that many communities don't have access to clean water. Because whenever the native communities signed the treaties with the government of Canada, they were not allowed to fund or manage their own water treatment system. The responsibility was taken on by the federal government, that they are responsible to provide clean water to the people, as far as the indigenous people are concerned. But, you know, there was no care, as we have soon seen in many other issues, that they had to fight for it, they had to go to court for it. And for decades, there have been many, many, you know, communities in Ontario and in other provinces where they cannot use the tap water for themselves or their family and their children. It's not that the government has not done anything since Trudeau came to power. They've invested about $2 billion in that. And so they are working towards it, but they have not really reached the mark by a five-year plan that they had. Is they have reduced the number. In 2016, there were 105 communities of indigenous people who were not able to use the water which comes on their tap. They had to buy the water or get it supplied from some other places. But by last year, in the middle of 2021, the numbers have gone down from 105 communities to 33 communities, actually, which is not a bad number. But, you know, it is not acceptable according to the resources that Canada has. Even if you look at the last year's general report by Auditor General Karen Hogan, she was very clear about it, that I'm very concerned and honestly disheartened that this long-standing issue is still not resolved. Access to safe drinking water is a basic human necessity. I don't believe anyone would say that this is in any way acceptable situation in Canada in 2021. And so, you know, and then the First Nations also filed a class action suit against the government. And basically, the government has agreed to compensate them for the loss, you know, for approximately $8 billion. What I would say is that, you know, when we talk about the situation around the world, let us not ignore situation here locally. At least be aware about it. They are fighting on their own, which is fine, and I think one good thing that we see in this whole story of the water as far as the situation of the indigenous people is concerned, that at least in Canada we have a process by which the government can be held accountable. It is indeed very good to look at the document that Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu was salam that he wrote for Malik Ashtar about the rules of, you know, governance. What are the responsibility of different sectors of the government? Unfortunately, we cannot see a complete, you know, good model. You know, look at the Muslim countries around the world. I don't think there is any process like Auditor General giving a report about the activities of the government every year and holding the government responsible for it. And so at least this is a good sign that we see here. And while we cherish that, we should also be vigilant of what's going on and play our part in whatever way we can in order to relieve the situation and the suffering of those who are minorities these days, because we are also in that same category. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, increase our tawfiqat, give us more awareness, and may Allah keep this country safe. And give the wisdom to the leaders to fulfill their duty in the best manner. In Ahsan al-Hadith, Kitabullah al-Aziz, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Wal-Asr, Innal Insana lafi Khusr, Illa Alladhina Amanu wa Amila Salihat, Wa Tawasaw Bil-Haqqi, Wa Tawasaw Bil-Sabr. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه
سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم. In the majlis we had during the daytime on the 21st of Ramadan, I talked about the example of this lady, Sauda al-Hamdaniya from Yemen, who was a very strong supporter of Amir al-Mu'mineen in the Battle of Siffin. And there I talked about the situation where she had gone much later on to Muawiyah with a complaint about one of his officers who had been sent in that area. And how Muawiyah very arrogantly, you know, reacted to her, knowing that she's the one who was reciting poetry to encourage her brother and the Yemeni contingent of Ali's army in Siffin against Muawiyah and his army. And at that time, she recited two lines of poetry, extempore, where she said, you know, she remembers someone. She says, you know, Salla ala, that may Allah send his blessings, that when he was buried, justice was buried with him. Salla ala nafsin, that when he was buried, sar al adlu madfunan. Justice also became buried with it. And so Muawiyah says, whom are you referring to? And she says, I am remembering Ali, because I went with a similar complaint about his revenue officer, and he didn't behave the way you reacted to me. He was in Salat, and he, you know, when he finished, he says, what is the issue? And I presented the case. And Ali raised his hand and he said, oh Allah, you be witness. I have not allowed my officers to be unjust to the people. And he wrote a letter there recalling the officer to investigate the case. That's what we, you know, when we talk about where is Islam, where are Muslims? These ideals are there, the concepts are there, but we unfortunately have not been able to live according to it. You know, look at this issue of water. Let me go back to my theme. You know, even in the state of war, Islam does not allow the Muslims to poison the water source of the enemy or to deny water to the prisoners of war, for example. In the Battle of Siffin, Muawiyah had reached to that area before the army of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And he stationed his soldiers on both sides of the river with the intention that when Ali's people come, they will prevent them from coming to prevent them from the access to water. And so when Amir al-Mu'mineen's, you know, soldiers, the army reached there and they realized, you know, these soldiers of Muawiyah are denying us the access to the river, they came to Ali. And Amir al-Mu'mineen selected Sa'sa bin Sawhan, who was a very eloquent and a courageous companion of Ali. Ali said, you go and meet Muawiyah. Tell him, what is this nonsense? So Sa'sa bin Sawhan goes there, and you know, let me just read to you what he said. He said, we have come to this area, and we don't want to start a fight without first exhausting arguments. We would like to negotiate and talk with you. What are the issues before we fight? You have come with your forces from Syria and have already started the fight by preventing us from water. This is cowardice, that you have created this barrier between us and water. You better remove the barriers, and if you want to maintain the status quo and want us to fight on water so that the victor gains control of it, then we are equally ready and capable of doing that. So it was a, you know, trying to peacefully resolve the problem, but also making him realize that, you know, don't think that we are weak. Muawiyah was feeling already victorious by what he had done. He turned to his advisors, people like Walid and Abdullah bin Abi Sara, who had been exiled from Medina during the days of the Prophet. You know, and they said, no, we will make them suffer the way they denied water from Uthman, the third Khalifa. You know, remember that it was Ali who sent his sons Hassan and Hussein with food and water to the house of Uthman when the Muslims had besieged the house of Uthman. And so they are remembering those days and they are saying, you know, no, we'll make them, you know, suffer the way Uthman suffered from food and drink in Medina. There was one of them, Abdullah bin Abi Sarah, who said that, you know, we will prevent them now the way Allah will prevent them from water on the day of Qiyamah. This was too much for Sa'sa. He couldn't be silent there. He says, إِنَّمَا يَمْنَعُهُ اللَّهُ أَلْفَجَرَ وَشَرَبَتُ الْخَمْرُ لَعَنَكَ اللَّهُ وَلَعَنَ هَذَا الْفَاسِقُ. You know, he said, you and your friend both deserve this you know, la'an of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he returned and he reported to Amir al-Mu'mineen, and Amir al-Mu'mineen asked his army to just, you know, attack. And the forces of Muawiyah on this side of the river were forced to retreat. About 7 of them were killed. And Amir al-Mu'mineen gained control on the river now. The only person who actually had advised Muawiyah against what he was doing was Amr ibn As. Because Amr ibn As had told him in presence of Sa'sa bin Sohan that if Ali had come here before us, he would not do this to us. And so now when Ali gained control of the river, Amr ibn As asked Muawiyah, what do you think now Ali will do? Is he going to give us access to water? And this is where Muawiyah says, I don't think he will prevent us from water, because he has not come to prevent us from water. His purpose is something else. And in Arabic, there is a saying, Al-Fadlu ma shahida bihi al-Ada. You know, the true quality of a person is when the enemy acknowledges that. And so even Muawiyah is forced to acknowledge that, and that was the reality. Amir al-Mu'minin said, this river is accessible to both sides. We have gained control, but we are not going to prevent the army of Muawiyah from access to this water. Salawat. This is where you see that, you know, Ali is remembered even now, after centuries, as Sautul Adalat al-Insaniya, the voice of human justice. You know, water is a very basic right. Asking for it, or even begging for it, is not a sense of, you know, feeling of humiliation, as opposed to food. If I don't have anything to eat, for me to go on the street or sit down and beg from people, you know, I'm hungry. You have this sense of humiliation. But if you run out of water and you don't have it, you will not feel any sense of humiliation to go and ask that, you know, can you give me water? On the day of Ashura, Hussein ibn Ali never said, we are hungry. He only asked for water. And this is where we see, and he's not even asking for himself. He says, if you think I'm going to drink the water, I have this six months old baby with me. You know, you come and give him water yourself. And there also, these words were used by Ibn Ziyad. In the command that he gave to Umar ibn Sa'd, he used the same words that we see in the Muawiyah circle, that prevent Hussein and his family from water the way Uthman was prevented. They did not realize it was Hussein who took water to the house of Osman on the command of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And this is where, you know, when we see the difference between the akhlaq of the Ahlul Bayt and others, this is where we come to realize that this is true Islam, and that is why we take pride in calling ourselves Shia of Ali and Shia of Ahlul Bayt. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidul Mursaleen wa Shafi'il Mudhunibin, Shafi'il Mudhunibin, Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina Abil Qasim Muhammad. وعلى إمام المتقين وأمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان ما أحيى صال البدء والطغيان هادي بأمنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فر البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.